the stress is also looming large from all directions, fear from disease, the workplace, whether our jobs would be going to be there or not. Then there are a lot of distractions. We all are working from home with children huddled up. Especially there's no support also on the domestic shore side, and all the negative news which is springing from the all corners. So this adds up to a lot of stress and distraction, and I would say it's not good for our health. It's not good for our health, productivity, and well-being, and is impacting everyone. Whether it's big or small, small businesses, big businesses, employees, children, homemakers, and perhaps the entire human race today is grappling with just one sentiment, and that's stress. And distraction too. We need a peaceful mind to handle all of it. How do we handle the stress and the related distractions? Mindfulness is going to be the pivotal part of our discussion today. And it's my privilege to who will be leading the discussion today. So Sapan is the founder at Monk at Work, and he's a mindfulness. Monk at Work is a specialized consulting firm, and he's a thought leader on mindfulness at workplace, and comes with an extensive 20 years of practice and study in mindfulness. So I would request now Sapan to take over and take us through the webinar. Over to you, Sapan.
Thanks so much, Vinti. Thanks for the very useful context and the kind intro. It's absolutely such a privilege to be with so many like-minded people today here when we are in these isolated situations. So special thanks to all of you on that account. I hope I am audible. Vinti can possibly confirm, and that we have chat window available. So my request to all of you is please use chat window to become interactive with each other. I think that is right now the only mode with which we can really connect with each other. So thanks so much. I can already see messages from people, so I know that we are all connected. Now, before even we start, let me make an unusual request to you. For just a few seconds, just become aware of your surroundings. Look at the room in which you are sitting. Look at the walls. Look at the ceiling. The colors. The objects in the room. The place where you are seated. The device you are using. Your posture. And also become aware of your state of mind. Thank you. That was just to bring our scattered minds to this present setting. Thanks again. So one more thing. See, this session is not about giving you some calm feeling or nirvana feeling by doing some quick mindfulness exercise. It's nice. It's nice, but it's very short-lived. And we are not here for a sprint. We are here to make a beginning for a marathon by gaining absolutely concrete understanding about the mechanism of mindfulness in very specific context of stress and distractions. So now let's take a very quick context on stress and distraction. I think we all have been hearing about stress being a killer all the time, and it actually is. By accelerating some of the life-threatening diseases, stress is killing millions of people every year. If you look at our workplaces, 120,000 people die in US alone just out of work stress. And as we see, 80% people at work are stressed out. Closer to home, We had a very recent case where a very senior executive in an IT company in Mumbai, 53 years of age, collapsed in the midst of a meeting presentation, a massive heart attack. Apparently, he was under very high delivery pressures for some work from home projects. Now, we might feel that our situation is not as bad, but believe me, we are killing ourselves with micro stressors constantly, all the time. And these micro stressors are equally bad in the longer run. So we really need to do something about it. Now, let's take distraction. Now, while stress harms us and attacks us, distractions ensure that we have very limited, we remain very limited, very extremely limited in everything that we want to achieve, whether it is happiness, whether it is health, whether it is productivity, whether it is success. Nicholas Carr wrote a book called The Shallows, where he mentioned how we are losing our core human capabilities of deep thinking, of contemplation, of reflection. More around mechanism of both stress and distraction in just a few minutes. Now, both stress and distraction collaborate with each other. So stress creates more distraction, distraction creates more stress. They both feed on each other. Both are governed by a complex mechanism called mind. If we want to really win over stress and distraction, we must understand the mechanism of mind through which stress and distraction operate. You're saying understanding mind in 45 minutes, that's impossible. Yeah. Let's do it in 2 minutes. Yeah, we will. We will do a quick exercise for 2 minutes and observe our mind. How? I'll set a timer for 2 minutes. When I say start, you will just close your eyes and start noticing what's happening inside your mind. That's it. Please remember, you don't have to control anything. You don't have to pacify anything. You don't have to, cut out anything. You just have to be a neutral observer. Yeah. Are you all ready? If you can just write yes in your chat windows, I'll know that you are ready for this. Great. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Okay. So I'm setting the timer for 2 minutes and your time starting now. Okay, 2 minutes are over. You can open your eyes. I know it would have felt like an eternity. Okay, so now hope everybody is back and with me. And to test that, let me ask you one question. What happened? Just write a single word or maybe a phrase in the chat box. What happened? Very nice. We have started getting some of the comments. And there are a variety of things. So some people are listening to the sound around, some people are sitting calm, some people are having a lot of thoughts, talking to own thoughts, there were current issues, thoughts, and very nice. Some of you would have been waiting for when will this 2 minutes get over? And by the way, it was not 2 minutes. I set the timer only for 90 seconds, but look how big, how long 90 seconds are. One of the most common observations, thanks, please continue to share. And I will also share simultaneously what we have seen a most common recurrence. So for the first 10, 15 seconds, your mind is silent, calm. But after that, you are hijacked by some of the thoughts which are related to very current situations. So right now, what's happening around you? So maybe it would be related to work, family, or anything. And that comes to your mind. And after that point, you are on a world tour. Somebody is writing Corona, absolutely right. Yeah, you're on a world tour. Okay. And then you are hopping from one thought to another. This was just 90 seconds. But imagine what happens if you have been sitting here for last 2, 3, or 4 minutes like this. Okay. That's how our mind works. Okay. Now, let me also ask you, as you have seen mind and we are trying to understand mind, let me ask you one more question. What does it tell you about the nature and habits of mind? So it's not our own mind. In general, what do you think? What is the nature and habit of mind overall, largely? And you can write these in your chat window. Always on the go, can't stop. Hungry. Okay. Thank you. I think good. And whatever you're writing, let me just summarize it by the backup of science. I can see, and most of the things are coming close to the things which science says. Now, science says there are three issues with mind. Mind wandering, distractions, and agitations. And these three, let's understand in detail. And we'll go to first mind wandering. Mind wandering is a state when I'm physically here, but my mind has gone somewhere else without me being aware of it. In that situation, I can be manually active. I can be doing physical activities, but I'm intellectually zero. I cannot do something conscious, creativity, or some problem solving, intellectually zero. Now, let me ask you a question again. How much percentage of the time do you think our mind wanders, generally, approximately? And you can write that again in the chat window. Your approximation, 50%, every time, 90%, yeah, 75, 90, more than 90, 99%, we are just, yeah, okay. Very nice, thanks so much for expressing this. And let me again add a study into this. Daniel Gilbert and one more researcher in 2010, they did a very extensive study on mind wandering. They found our mind wanders 47% of the time. 47% means our half of the intellectual capacity just goes down the drain. And this study was in 2010, and we are sitting in 2020. I think this 47% is too old, and what you are saying this 47 could be 74, 84, 94, we don't know. But look at how much our mind wanders and it takes away all our productive capacity. But not only that, and listen to this carefully. When this study was published, it was published under the heading, "A Wandering Mind is an Unhappy Mind," which means whenever our mind wanders, it creates a very deep, unhappy state inside us. So when our mind wanders, not only makes us less productive, but it even takes away the joy of life. It's a very bad deal. So that's distraction. That's mind wandering. Now let's come to distractions. Distractions are generally seemingly harmful, trivial, but I think we need to look at it in quite detail. And for that, let's go back in time to our school days. Remember those 3-hour long examinations? When we used to start writing the examinations, as soon as we start writing examination, 10, 15 minutes, our mind would go here and there, not focused. But after that, it started to settle down gradually. At one point, we didn't even remember that there is a world outside that hall. Yeah. And this happens even today. So when you are possibly making a presentation or preparing a report or doing something really intellectually stimulating, for first 10, 15 minutes, you need time to get really focused. And after that, the rhythm sets in. After that, you go deep. Is it right? Yeah. Now the question is, why so? Why don't we get to the optimum level at the almost instantly? Why doesn't? The reason is our mind is in constant commotion all the time, continuously. So when we start to focus on one thing, then it starts to settle down gradually. That commotion is happening and now it starts to settle down. It starts to settle down, stabilize. Then it becomes focused, more focused. Then it becomes deep. That's how the mechanism of mind works. And as we stabilize, as the mind gets focused, as the mind goes deep, that's where the seat of productivity, creativity, innovation, flow, the work fulfillment, the joy of work, the real productivity, the accuracy, all these things come when we are not here, when we are here. The secret is simple. It takes time. It may be 10 minutes, it may be an hour, but we need time to go deep. And that's where we reach those optimum levels. Even for reaching basic level of productivity, we need some level of stability. But what happens with us? And let me ask you this question again. How frequently do we get distracted? Any thoughts? You can write in the chat window. How frequently do we get distracted? Very often, okay. Quite easily, always. Oh my God, I think I'm not even seeing every 5 minutes, every 10 minutes or every 2 minutes. It's saying almost always. And you are so right. We check our phones every 12 minutes. I think that's not a surprise. We get distracted every 40 seconds, every 40 seconds when we are sitting in front of the computer. Can you imagine this? Where we are talking about going deep and getting the best optimum level. And here we are talking about 40 seconds. So look at what happens with us. So we are trying to go deep, distraction, deep, distraction, deep, distraction. We are never even able to go to the very basic level of productivity. Let's forget about very deep thinking, deep contemplation, and some great insights. We are not reaching some basic levels. It's a problem. We are not even operating at possibly a 5% capacity, which is bad. I mean, for a human life to waste so much of potential, it's bad. And that's what distraction does to us. So this was distraction and wandering. And now let's come to the third part of the mind issues that we're talking about, is the stress and agitation. Now, our mind is very insecure. Mind and body evolved for survival. And that's important. Survival needs to take precedence over everything, because if we are not alive, nothing else matters. But this survival instinct has gone to such maddening level, to such super sensitive level, that we are almost touching the level of insanity. Think about it. I mean, imagine that we are driving in huge traffic. Oh, by the way, it's been such a long time that we did that. But just recall the time when we were doing that. We were in huge traffic and somebody else just did a very dangerous overtake, and we get angry. Now, when we are angry, how does our body react? Do you remember? Even you can feel the anger inside right now and see how your body reacts. Our fist clench. We grit our teeth. We are almost ready to attack. Are we an animal who is going to use our claws and jaws to tear someone apart? What is this? This was the behavior which might be required and fine millions of years ago when we were living in jungles. But today, we are using the same instinctive reactions for current realities. Even in front of your family members or your colleagues or your boss, we are displaying, if not displaying, at least we are feeling such type of reactions. What is this? They are not lions and tigers. Why is that? It's the old mind still sitting in our new body. And this old mind is called amygdala. Amygdala is just in the center here, the small part of the brain. It's also called the mammal brain, being the oldest part of the brain. Amygdala triggers all the emotional reactions and stress responses whenever it perceives danger or threat. Interesting part about amygdala is it works on autopilot system, which means it does not require instruction from us. If we are not conscious enough, autopilot system will get activated and it will make us do things which we would regret. Happens with us many times. Yeah. So how can we control amygdala? By being more alert, more aware. With our attentiveness, this part of the brain sitting here, prefrontal cortex, gets strengthened. The higher the control of prefrontal cortex on amygdala, more balanced our emotional responses are. But look at us today. Our mind wanders, we are getting distracted. How much time we are alert, aware? You remember we did the being awareness of the surroundings? How many of us were actually aware of the surroundings earlier? We are not. We are half sleepy. And that's where our autopilot system, our amygdala, has become so strong that it makes us take those immediate reactions. So that's the third part. Now look at it. Our mind wanders, our mind gets distracted, our mind gets agitated. And in the process, it takes away everything that we value, our health, our happiness, our success, our relationships. And it's not that we get into such wandering, distraction, agitation, sometimes sporadically. As we just saw, it has become part of our life. We almost always wander. We almost always are distracted. We are almost always anxious, worried, concerned, agitated, stressed out. Something or other is happening. This is bad. This is bad for us. This is bad for people around. And this is bad for this world. So the question is, what do we do? Is there an alternative mode to operate this mechanism called mind? Let's find out. Let's do another eye closing exercise together. Yeah, are you ready for it? It had been quite a monologue, so let me see some yes from you. Okay, great. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you so much. Okay, so let's start this exercise, and I would request you all to gently close your eyes. Close your eyes. And as you close your eyes, make your body absolutely comfortable in whatever posture you are. Sitting, standing, lying down, become comfortable. Relax your whole body. If you have to move your body, do that, but completely relaxed. Observe your posture and see that you are completely relaxed. Look at your legs. Are they easily placed wherever you are sitting, or you want to move them? How about your feet? Are they firmly placed on the ground or anywhere else? How about your back and neck? Is your back straight? Is your neck straight? At this point, become aware of the fact that you are breathing. Notice the movement of air. The air going in and coming out. Just become attentive of the process of breathing. Now, very slowly, take your attention to your feet. Observe the skin of your feet. Observe the touch of your skin of the feet with the footwear or the ground or anywhere else it is placed. Notice the touch of your thighs on the place of seating. Now, notice the touch of your back, the skin of your back on your clothes. At this point, let's gradually take our attention to the sounds around you. There might be some sounds inside your room or place where you are. These may be subtle sounds or heavy sounds. There may be continuous sound like of air conditioner. Don't try to search, just observe anything that you hear right now. Now, let's take our attention back to our body and observe the weight of your body on the place of seating. observe how your body is pressing on the place of sitting. Now, let's come back to our breathing. And again, focus on the natural flow of our breathing. Take one deep breath in and slowly out. Take one more deep breath in and slowly out. Okay, and now whenever you feel comfortable, you can slowly open your eyes. Very slowly, as you feel comfortable. Okay, let's come back. I hope everybody is back. I know. Thanks. Somebody is actually writing. You would have felt sleepy. But let me ask you to give a very quick reflection. How do you feel right now? Or how did you feel this in this exercise? Just write a very quick word, very quick phrase, anything that you want to write down. Relaxing, peace, calm, mind recharged, aware, energized, feeling sleepy. I'm sure that would also be happening. Lightheaded, relaxed. Very nice. Thank you. You keep writing. Now look at it. In this quick exercise, we just experienced things like calm, focus, energy, being in present. All of these are antidotes to what we have been discussing till now. Mind wandering, distraction, agitation, things which we thought have become part of our life. We thought mind wandering, distraction, agitation are the way of living. 90%, 99% we are living like that. But this exercise gives us a confidence that it's not the destiny. We can do something about it. It was just a glimpse. 3.5 minutes, we did it. And we could reach these levels. It gives us confidence that wandering, distraction, agitation, stress, are only bad habits. They are not our destiny. And bad habits can be changed by doing the right things. Yeah. Now, let me ask you a question and very strange thing. If you remember, in the first exercise, 2-minute exercise, I didn't ask you to do anything. But in the second exercise, I made you do so much hard work. Go to your feet, go here, go to the breathing, go to the sound. You were constantly in action. But you are saying that you are more relaxed, more calm in the second exercise and not in the first exercise. How is that? How is that possible? And what is the difference between this first exercise and second exercise? Any thoughts? You may want to write down. In the chat window. Mind needs guide. Okay, nice. Okay, a few of the answers have come and you're right. But let me also share with you one fundamental difference. The biggest difference between the first exercise and the second exercise. Yeah, everything you're writing is true, but the fundamental difference, let me share. Consider the mind is like a kid, a very, very naughty kid. And this kid is continuously running around here, there, not staying at one place continuously. And we are a half sleepy or almost sleepy parent. Then this kid holds our hand and drags us along. And we are in half sleepy state. We are just getting dragged by this wandering kid mind, by this distracted kid continuously. And as we get dragged, we get exhausted. We get stressed out and we are out of control. But in the second exercise, for the first time, you took charge, you took command, and you said, mind, go to my feet. Mind, go to the sounds, go to the breathing, go to my legs. That is the first time when you are stable, you are centered, and you are directing the mind around. And this is what makes the whole difference. Whether are we getting unconsciously dragged by the mind, or are we centered and we are directing the mind around? The exercise that we did right now was a glimpse, was a trailer of mindfulness. Mindfulness is nothing but an attention training technique. In a way, so that our attention is brought in here, in this moment. It is brought to sustain and it is brought to deepen. So bring the attention here, sustain it, and deepen it. That's all the exercise of mindfulness. So now, and before we go to the quiz time, as it appears on the screen, now science shows that as we do this, mindfulness, magic happens, wonder happens. Oxytocin and serotonin level goes up, enhancing our happiness, improving our heart health and blood pressure. Our cortisol levels go down. Cortisol is the stress hormone. More cortisol, more stress. Our thinking becomes deep. Our creativity increases. Our relationships become better. There are more than 10,000 papers on these and many more areas. And you need not believe me. I think after the session, you should go back and do your own search and see it. But now I think enough of monologue. Let's go to the quiz time. Let's take a quick quiz. Are you ready for this? You can say yes, so that I just know that you are together with me. Thank you. You know, this is so good to see this chat window, because that way I know that I'm connected with you. Otherwise, I have no means to know your mind. Yeah. So let me ask you questions one by one. There are three questions. These are objective type questions, and this is open book question, which means you can use Dr. Google to find the answers. But please remember, when you open your phone or browser, please make sure that it should not drag you into anything else. Okay. Have that control. So here is the first question. Which is one of the earliest institutions to scientifically do the research on mindfulness? And you can write your answers in the chat window. Okay, don't know. It's fine. It's an open book exam. So, okay, I can see almost everything. Harvard, MIT is the mostly, Stanford also has come up. Ramakrishna Mission has also come up. Very nice. Now, you would see Harvard a lot in mindfulness research at this point of time. But, and simply because Harvard is doing excellent work at this point of time, if you search HBR and mindfulness, you will see so many leadership articles and all on this. But in 1970s, MIT's medical school is where some milestones happened. The person called John Kabat-Zinn, for the first time, he did a RCT, random control technique, testing on stress. So using mindfulness and traditional stress methods, and how's the difference? And they were shocked to see the results. And once they realized there is a proven effect on stress, then scientists started researching it on many other areas. So today, these 10,000 research papers are on all areas, from your sports performance to workplace performance to our health to our overall well-being, mental health, everything is there. So at this point of time, almost all of these institutes are doing wonderful work. There is Oxford has got Oxford Mindfulness publication, and almost all these universities have got their own departments of mindfulness. Let's move to the next question. So which is the company, we spoke about the institution, which is the company which pioneered the adoption of mindfulness? And you can again do your research. There are a lot of Google, and in between Mitsubishi also there, Microsoft also there. Very nice. And as you are answering, let me give the answer as well. The right answer is the majority that has given the answer. It's Google. While not the Google was the first one to start using mindfulness, even some reports say, and I'm not sure, even Apple, Steve Jobs was a big proponent of mindfulness in the organization. But it was Google who did it very systematically in the organization. They even had an internal course called Search Inside Yourself. And once Google adopted it, it really spread. They found it's working tremendously for them. And then I think today, most of these organizations and many other organizations are already adopting mindfulness. You look at any Fortune 500 company and they have adopted mindfulness in one or the other way. SAP has even got a chief mindfulness officer. That's quite interesting. And they have they did such a strong internal practice of mindfulness that they are now consulting external organizations, their clients, in mindfulness. That's a great progress. Third question. I'm moving a bit fast, simply in the interest of time. I know we can just keep talking about these things for hours. So this is the third and last question. Research proven benefits of mindfulness. And again, if you can check, we are not talking about, I feel mindfulness should help. There is a research which proves that yes, here it can help. Some are saying productivity, all, many of you are saying all of the above. Okay. All, actually you're right. I was trying to trick you into the question and I did not give you the choice all of the above, but you're right. You're right, it's all of the above. It started with stress reduction, productivity, leadership, sleep, a big problem, memory. And these are just five things that we have mentioned. If you see, mindfulness has been working in all the major domain areas of our life, everything. So mindfulness has been researched a lot, and these are the proven benefits, global proven benefits from some of the largest universities. And it's a highly adopted practice. Look at it, 13% of US employees are already trained in mindfulness. It's already a $1.1 billion industry in USA. Novak Djokovic, he wrote a book called Serve to Win. And there he writes, my mindfulness practice is as important as my physical practice. I mean, that's simply amazing. Now, mindfulness is highly researched, highly adopted. The world is adopting it. There's so much happening around and we know how much it can benefit us from distraction, wandering, stress, to peace, calm, resilience, control. But unfortunately, we have been missing out on this treasure till now. But now that we have this technique in our hand, it's time to make the best use of it. Today is the situation when we need it even more. The world the crisis that the world is going through right now is absolutely unprecedented. Nobody has any certainty about the solution. Nobody has certainty about the duration. Now, it creates a lot of stress. As we are trying to work on something, it creates a lot of distraction. But that's where we can use this opportunity to build our resilience muscles, to build our focus muscles. So the question is, how do we do it? How exactly we should adopt mindfulness in our life? So there is a long answer, but let me give you two things very quickly. Number one, start your mindful gym, daily mindful gym, which means start practicing mindfulness for 5 minutes, 10 minutes, 15 minutes in your daily life, whichever way. And how to do it? We just got a glimpse. A better one is an audio guided practice where you are brought into the present experience, present exercise. There are more than 1300 apps. So use any app. Just sit. What an amazing thing. Our life can get transformed by just sitting 5-10 minutes and doing nothing. Just listen to the instructions and follow those instructions inside mind. But believe me, it's not so easy. As we start doing it, you will realize how many complications are there inside it. But beginning with it is the greatest start. It's the greatest achievement. Okay. That is the first thing. Second, start mindful awareness. So besides your 5-10 minute mindful gym, starts mindful awareness. What it means? Next time you feel internally agitated, you feel stressed out, you feel distracted, you feel overwhelmed, any of the uncomfortable feelings occur to you, remind yourself to take a few seconds and become aware of the surroundings. Become aware of the surroundings. Even if you can take a few seconds in doing this, it will start building your mindful habits. It will start strengthening prefrontal cortex, and it will help you in reducing the effects of amygdala reactions. Okay, these two things, and I'm not saying that these two things will make you completely mindful, but it's a great beginning. Humans are the operating system of this world, fortunately or unfortunately. And mind is the operating system of humans. Imagine how peaceful, how prosper, how kind, how cohesive this world would be if we have more and more mindful people around. This world needs more and more mindful soldiers. If we want to have a great world where we all can live happily in prosperity, where we can resiliently manage and face challenges like we are facing right now, our individual minds and our collective minds need to become more and more mindful. Okay. And the beginning, the start happens with us. It has to start with us. We have to make a beginning. Mindfulness for us is a gift. We consider it as a big gift to us. And that's the reason we keep spreading it out. Through our social projects, we are working on three areas. One is government departments. Second is sports. And third is education. Now, my request to all of you is that please, if you think that you have found something useful, not only practice yourself, but please practice it along with others. Spread the message. Help people understand the science behind it. Whatever name people want to practice, see, people have got a lot of thoughts about whether I use mindfulness or there are so many techniques around bringing the mind to the present moment. Please forget about the term. It's not the term which is important. It's about the state of mind that we get. So please use any technique, anything that you think works for you, but start spreading the message with your family, with the society, with your colleagues. In this moment, this is the best time when you are sitting inside home, take out some 10, 15 minutes and do a mindfulness practice together. This can be one of the best bonding exercise. We have helped organizations in doing remote exercises. So, and you can do that. You can make a group and give the common practice, 5-10-15 minute practice that they can use. And you can come together online and do the mindfulness together, 15 people, 20 people, 30 people. Wouldn't that be an amazing thing? People keep asking about good apps, and very quick answer is, see, the app is very, unique to your own choice. But there are two apps which top the chart by the number of subscriptions. So I'm saying from that angle, whether it suits your purpose or not, I would really don't know. So one is Headspace and second is Calm. These two are really, really popular apps, and you can check, but check and explore many more. We found most of the good apps have the Western context and Western accent. So we developed our own audios in the Indian context, which we do license to the organizations. If you would need, I can share a 15 minute audio with you. So you can possibly write to Fikki, write to Monk at Work, and we'll definitely share with you. So with this, my part is over. And Vinti, I'm not sure if we have any time left for Q&A, or if you want to do that, you may suggest, please.
Yes, Sapan, I think we have 7 minutes with us. Okay. If everyone is willing to stay put for next 5-7 minutes, we can perhaps have Sapan for 4 minutes, and then we can all log off.
Sure.
So you can all chat in your chat windows if you all are ready to extend it to, say, 5 minutes. Can I see some responses?
So you can either say yes, or you can say
yes. People are ready.
You can send your question. Oh, thank you. Thank you.
Yeah, in fact, Sapan, we are getting all yes. And
thanks so much. Thanks so much.
Yeah.
Oh, very nice. Somebody is actually saying, let's start a next 3-day challenge to start mindfulness journey. And thanks so much. Let's do that. Do you have a website? Yes, we do have a website called Monk at Work, monkatwork.in.
In fact, it's a nice, it would be good idea for everyone to, ask Sapan some questions, which he can take at this point in time. You can all write your questions in the chat window, and Sapan can take perhaps one by one, Sapan, we can take the questions.
Sure. If at all there are questions. So somebody is asking how meditation is helpful in mindfulness. Now, meditation, mindfulness, if we see all these techniques which bring our attention to the present moment, they all originate from the same source. Rather, mindfulness, and as per research and all the originators of the term mindfulness says, it starts from the Buddhist mindful meditation practice. They just have taken out possibly the spiritual context, and it's like from yoga. The spiritual context is taken out and health context is taken. So mindfulness is just being taken out and researched for the purpose of science and for the purpose of our current level productivity. So there is a little variation in the technique, but they all work with the same principles. How can we check the process we are following? Is so nice question. Thank you so much for asking this. Okay. Let me take 2 minutes to answer this. There are two benchmarks that you can follow. One is awareness. Now, how much are you keeping aware? So what would happen when you will practice? Your mind will wander, your mind will go away, and then you will bring it back. Over a period, see how much you are being present, how much you are being aware. That's the first benchmark. The second benchmark is very interesting. It's called being relaxed. Many times to be aware, we become too strained. And strained is not mindfulness, it's concentration. So we are not here for concentration, relaxed. I'm completely present right now, right here, absolutely aware in this moment, but I'm relaxed. So when you check your progress, see and ask yourself, am I aware? Am I relaxed? Am I aware? Am I relaxed? And you will see that sometimes you'll be more aware, less relaxed, more relaxed, less aware. And we need to just build on both the things. Yeah. There is a question, when will be the next session? I think Vinthi would be able to answer that later possibly. Fikki and Monk at Work are planning to do a lot of activities and a lot of things around mindfulness, and we will keep you updated on that. So thanks for asking this. There are actually a few more people who are asking many more sessions, and we may have a follow-up session around this. Let's see.
I think the response has been great, and we would love to have more sessions in the future. I would request each one of you to keep following Fikki Quality Forum on LinkedIn, Facebook, and Twitter. Please also follow Fikki India on Facebook, LinkedIn, and Twitter. And there we share all our updates. We've been doing a lot of work on process, a lot of work on people and planet, a lot of activities that we keep doing. So I would request each one of you to keep following, keep tab on these social media pages, and we'll let you know when the next session is planned.
And you can also follow Monk at Work page on, again, Facebook, Twitter, LinkedIn. There also we keep updating it. So Fikki and Monk at Work, both places you can look at. Again, another question is the inspiration for this journey. So during school time, I got introduced to meditation, and it helped me get a lot of good marks. I got really interested in, I started using it. I started helping my friends as well. And then the journey continued. And when I got to know about the science of mindfulness and how it is spreading out in the world, that's when, you know, the interest level even grew after that. I don't know if I'm missing out on any other questions, because there are a lot of chats here. Vinthi, do help me please if I have missed out on any other questions. How much time is required to practice daily? There is no limit. Ideally speaking, if you can start with anything from 5 minutes, 10 minutes, 15 minutes. So, you know, gradually increasing now, you know, we are reaching to 30 minutes, 45 minutes, 1 hour. So it's like exercise, you know, as much as doesn't mean the whole day, but I think 15 minutes to 30, 45 minutes is a very good practice.
So I think Sapan, we reached 5 o'clock, and I think the time just blew away. Before we wind up, I'll just leave everyone with one update that, you know, at the Fikki HR desk at Fikki Quality Forum, we also have a Fikki HR committee. Where we have very senior HR people who are helping us devise an agenda for the HR professionals. For the past 3 weeks for Indian businesses, due to COVID-19, lockdown has been really drastic. You know, the supply chain has been disrupted and the imports are all down, and, you know, the businesses have been actually hit very hard. So we have also planned a series of webinars for the Indian businesses. We can have SMEs and MSMEs also joining in, where we do guidance on HR issues, guidance on business and tax issues, coaching and counseling in the area of mental health and tenacity. And also, how do you handle remote teams in such a scenario? So I would again request you, as I mentioned, please keep a tab on all our social media handles. We'll shortly share the schedule of the webinars, which are planned in the coming next week. So with this, I think, Sapan, we are good to wrap. And,
sure. Let me just take this opportunity to thank Fikki. I think this was, you know, the initiative that is taken by Fikki in this direction is really commendable, and other things that also spoken by Vinthi. really, really nice. And Mrityunjay and Vinti have been driving these initiatives quite passionately. So thanks, special thanks to them. Thanks to Chandan for helping out. And friends, webinar is an extremely, extremely limited medium in terms of interaction. But because of your participation, because of your interaction, we could actually, we did not feel that we are not together. So thanks so much for being so participative, and I'm really hoping to connect with you soon.
So, and I would also request
wishing you a very, very wishing you best wishes for your mindfulness journey, and you stay safe and stay healthy.
I would also request each one of you to please share your feedbacks on my email ID, that is vinti.mehrotra@fiki.com, and also let us know what type of webinars would you want us to, you know, hold on. So that's a wrap at our end. I would really want to thank Sapan. Thanks each one of you for joining in. And you know, I think the entire science of mindfulness is what I understood from you, Sapan, is quite fascinating. You know, no matter how simple the toggle between the mind wandering to having you or your consciousness in the center controlling the rest of your body, it does need a lot of practice and discipline. Sure. The second thing that I really liked was concentration versus mindfulness, where in one state you're not stressed, your mind, you're aware and relaxed. So there's a lot of takeaways which we can take away from the webinar. And thank you so much for sharing your wealth of knowledge with us.
Thank you.
With this, we take a